packages. So if you're not a packager, anyway, it might be interesting, whatever, who knows. There's always a chance we might say something interesting. That's a bug. This thing is rather new, this remote control thing, so I'm still playing with it and hopefully debugging it. And who would think that we're releasing? In fact, the last release candidate is going live now. But anyhow, hopefully the... okay, perfect. So if you want to leave, do. You know, feel welcome. You know, but there'll be more of the same otherwise. So you know, you've been warned. Shall I just go?
Yeah, just
perfect, perfect. So this is what I'm going to say. I won't say more about it because I'm going to say it. Gosh, it looks very big and scary, that text, doesn't it? Perhaps it's better from further back. So why packaging LibreOffice is possibly the most challenging and fun thing you can be involved in. And here's why. So we have a lot of diversity in LibreOffice. You know, languages, programming languages are created regularly and get destroyed regularly as well. I don't know who's using Ruby on Rails today or Groovy or, you know, any of that sort of stuff. But, you know, there is a certain class of person that chases the latest cool language, leaving behind them a trail of wreckage and destruction, you know, as people endlessly have to support, you know, more millions of lines of code in a mix of languages. And lots of that kind of people have infested OpenOffice and the LibreOffice legacy for many years. So there's quite a lot of different choices of language. There's Java, you know, with all of its siblings. XSLT, do you know, it's a little known fact that XSLT is trending below COBOL. So, you know, if you want a cool language to choose to write your coding, you know, combining all of the elegance of Perl with all of the, XSLT. So, but don't worry, they generate C++ using XSLT. So that's all right. We have C, we have, you really need a working C++ compiler, which is also quite a trick if you're looking for that sort of thing. Python, we have bits in Python, Perl, Mono. We've got actually some more. We have a JavaScript interpreter written in Java called Rhino, which I forgot to put on the slide, and we have, various other crazy things, but they're much less used. So, you know, when the compile breaks, where it breaks, could be quite random, you know, and chasing it is quite fun. I mean, in terms of infrastructure, you know, we like to don't like to choose winners. So, you know, GNOME VFS and GIO, two different strata. GStreamer, two major versions. And, of course, we can dynamically link and choose which one we use. KDE 3 and KDE 4 and GDK 2 and GDK 3 and RAWX. And we will dynamically detect at runtime which you're using and try and use the right back end. That's pretty cool, huh? Poplar, OpenSSL, Mozilla NSS and OpenSSL. Again, you know, why pick one when you could have everything? You know, it's all good. So what else do we use? CUPS, LPR, PAM. Well, yeah, lots and lots of funky stuff. We have our own custom, we need a new GNU make, which I'll talk about in a minute. But lots of things, you know, image magic during the build to scale and, you know, do fun things with your images and so on. And that's before you've even laid out any text or done anything quite fun, you know, with right to left, Arabic mixed with Hebrew mixed with, you know, whatever. So there's some good things there. Also, you know, dependency-wise, you know, we just depend on everything. So if you're... We have this thing in OpenSUSE called Tumbleweed, which is great, and it provides the latest up-to-date, you know, it's kind of rolling distribution. But one of the great things about the build service, I don't know if you're here for Tim's talk earlier about it, because OpenSUSE was primarily, in the past, really a KDE company, and C++ has these wonderful ABI ripple effects. Pretty much whatever you do, you break the ABI, right? So the open build service tends to rebuild absolutely everything all the time in case there was an ABI problem. And stopping it doing that's quite hard. And one of the great things about that is that almost any package you check into the system is eventually going to cause a LibreOffice rebuild, which takes hours. And then, you know, there's hopefully an incremental update of that later. But, you know, it's kind of a bit bad. And there's one thing we'd love to do, you know, and if someone here is, you know, short of something to do, we would love to split some of these bits out because, of course, we abstract all this internally as well. You know, there's no shortage of abstractions. And it would be nice to have just a bit that does, the GTK KDE backend dependencies, so you recompile a small package instead of the whole thing. It's just a code movement and a packaging problem to deal with. So why do I get the ring of volume then instead of... Anyway. What else? We have platform dependencies, which are pretty nice. So our component model does some cool things. It produces C++ vtables and it'll produce and hand you an object that looks like a C++ object, but really is a pile of magic, you know? You call what looks like a virtual method, and really it jumps into, well, it actually jumps into a doubly memory mapped region of memory, because SE Linux didn't like us having executable heaps. So, you know, you have to generate these trampolines that are then executed, and it's all good fun. But that means also that as you package for these different platforms, you know, you're actually running different code, and there's not even enough sharing here. In a perfect world, we'd be using libffi for this sort of stuff. Anyone that wants to come and write the libffi bridge, again, that would be cool, because we could chop out a whole load of random platform-specific muck. And of course, there are other, you know, crazy platforms out there that are better or worse. Here are some other interesting things. So when you look at the IA64 ABI, you know, the Itanium, you know, designed from the bottom up as a 64-bit, very long instruction, you know, you would think it would be beautiful, right? Turns out there's a real size limitation in their ABI, such that we can't stick all of the stuff we want to in one section. And this works fine on 32-bit machines, you'll be interested to know, but not on IA64. So actually we have to disable random features just to get it to compile there, which is pretty depressing. What else? Oh yeah, so many things that you know compile on ARM, say, will not actually run anything there. So you know, you end up with something that compiles, but whether it runs, that's a different question. But by default, we run a whole load of unit tests actually during our build. It's quite hard to turn them off. It is possible. And depending on whether you do a single build of a module or a straight-through build, when you do a straight-through build, you load documents and save them and reload them again and check that, in fact, no data was lost, this sort of thing. Yeah, that's only about 5% of compile time, but the compile time is reasonably large, you know, particularly when you start getting to an exotic architecture like, you know, I don't know, Debian Alpha or whatever is being, touted as the latest thing. So, yeah, with 10,000 files, doesn't sound very many files, does it? But try writing, you know, 1,000 lines each in C++ and compiling it. Another thing that's quite interesting is that the parallelism we can expose is pretty cool nowadays. So we've run away from a DMake build system, which was really, really very bad indeed. And we've moved to GNU-Make instead, which is much, much better. We found several bugs in GNU-Make, but you can now load your whole dependency graph in, and after doing your header compiles, you know, you have all of those sort of bison things that produce code and, you know, IDL that generates code, but we do all that first, and then we can build, you know, something like 10,000 files wide. So if you want to contest your, you know, massive new multiprocessor machine, and the Linux kernel, which is in C, and so it compiles quite quickly, is actually not stressing it, then we can provide a stress test that, you know, for real men, you know, that will actually throw this ridiculous G++ at, you know, taking a second to compile each module and so on. So one slight downside of that is that we have just tons of dependency data that get generated, and there's just loads of grot in there. So that's also a challenge. And of course, many, you know, some people use compile farms. We use a thing called Ice Cream, which is, I don't know, has anyone used Ice Cream much? I've used I've used distcc. distcc is lamer. So Ice Cream is the SUSE version of that, and it does, you know, it pushes the compiler over the wire and generates chroot jails, so you can have different distributions at each end and so on. It's quite fun. But again, you know, you'll often find a machine that simply can't compile a file; it's too big. You know, in your cluster, it just dies. So yeah, and then of course, fitting it all onto a live CD is practically impossible. It's just too big out of the other end. And actually, fitting it even onto Android and getting our viewer under the 50 megabyte limit for the App Store is proving a real challenge. So yeah, I don't know. So that's some reasons why LibreOffice is a really cool thing to hack on. You know, it's a man's work. You know. There's or a woman's work. Now that's terribly sexist, isn't it? It's an adult's work. I'm sorry. You know, it's none of these. I don't know. There you are. Dig deeper. So another slight problem is that LibreOffice. You know, you think you just start packaging it. I like to use the example of René, who's kind of a hero. You know, you just pull a bit and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And so this guy. He's always laboring. A lot of the things that we add as dependencies, we add. For Windows, it's necessary to have them internally, so that we'll build them as part of our build system and build an MSI file out of the back end. And that's all cool, but there's a great temptation to do that on Linux as well, and this is thought to be a bad thing. So René is constantly ensuring you can build it split into hundreds of different pieces, which is great. Of course, you don't get that on Windows, So it's not possible. And as a result, he gets to maintain 80 plus packages for Debian, which is cool. So you know, the filter is added, a WordPerfect order filter, and then everyone starts reusing it. And you know, why put the Visio support in with the Microsoft Publisher support or the WordPerfect graphics or the Microsoft Work support? You know, so just hundreds of little libraries everywhere. Oh, and then someone writes some bindings for some random language in it, and you know, so the packages tend to proliferate like this. And so, you know, maybe for libvisio that's fine, but I mean, you know, we're still shipping OpenSSL bundled on Windows of a certain version, which is kind of a security nightmare if you want to be updating Windows machines. So what else? Well, CPP unit. So one of the things we find is sort of unmaintained things that don't quite do what we want to do, and CPP unit is one of those. So, you know, if you run a distro, do upgrade your CPP unit. That's a much better version that we have. GNU Make seems to be under-maintained. I think that's charitable. There are minor problems in it, like, you know, the glob. I don't know if you used glob before, but, you know, star, regular expression expansions and so on. Glob is what does it all for you. And, you know, passing the wrong options to glob has a serious performance impact, such that, you know, we factor of 10 faster for much of what we are doing just by changing a few flags in there, not running glob if it does nothing, and so on. So we got so fed up with waiting for GNU Make to do a new release, we now started to push those patches into distributions. I think there was some nasty thread-related crashes as well when you started loading loads of stuff, but anyhow, we're improving GNU Make as well. And the only slight problem with that is that the latest GNU Make breaks the Debian build. You know, there was one of the 3 million packages that requires some specific rule that busts something, so they haven't upgraded. What else? Oh, CMIS is a content manager protocol, so if you're talking to SharePoint and Alfresco and that sort of thing. And the spreadsheet guys, for some reason, like to write chunks of the spreadsheet in other libraries. So there's MDDS, AUKUS, and they're kind of heavily templatized something or others that do stuff. But and those tend to grow each time. Liblang tag is the latest trendy thing for tagging weirdo languages. So, you know, if you have your own distribution, I suggest you probably want to, you know, think about merging with someone else's or reusing theirs. But we have, I don't know, there are quite a lot more distributions, I think. But I hope we've got the main ones there. So get stuck in. One of the other nice things we do is we have predictable release schedule. You'd be surprised that this is controversial still in the world, but anyhow. So we release a 0.0 every 6 months, purely time-based. It may suck, totally. But that's all right. This avoids moral hazard. So in the past, you wouldn't believe the number of people out there that were simply leeching off other people by holding up the release to ensure that their customer bug was fixed before it went out. And that's kind of bad, you know? If you're not only going to inject stress into the community to get your bug fixed rather than actually any fixes, and you're going to, you know, sort of shout and scream and say it can't go until... And so we had sort of 2 month slips, you know, releases in which a whole load of apparently release blocker bugs were fixed, although, you know, the week after it was released, another 10 release blocker bugs of the same kind were found anyway. So we basically just ship it. And after a few releases, I think we've done, you know, 3.4, 3.5, 3.3, 3.6, quite a lot now, people are getting used to the idea that you need to test early, and preferably test master and so on. And we do this, I guess, the first week of February, the first week of August, both are really terrible times in the year for doing a release, because everyone's on holiday over Christmas or going on holiday in the summer. And then we do monthly bug fixes after that. And the aim, I mean, the whole point of this is that the 0.2 release, by the time you get to 3.6.2 or whatever, is really well synchronized with the major release distro releases. So hopefully what you get in your latest Ubuntu or Fedora or OpenSUSE when it happens to line up is something really good. That's the hope. If you like testing and working with us and helping iron out creases and so on, then do get involved with the 0.0s, but it is a 0.0. So. But at least it makes it predictable. And so, well, what do you package? I don't know. You can package each minor release. That's quite a lot of work, once a month, but, you know, worth doing. Or you can use an existing distribution release. Of course, we have branches in Git. So the SUSE commercial product is actually at that URL. Once you put tags in there. If you're a distro packager, you know, do push your own. One really great way to make other people do your work for you is to just set up a tinderbox, which will run all the time and, you know, build on your platform and find the problems, which is cool. And so far, from generic for Linux distributions, we have OpenSUSE, Fedora, Gentoo, and quotes generic Linux. Oh, and if you want to do a cool hack, there's a thing here with package kit integration. So I mentioned live CDs. LibreOffice doesn't fit on a live CD at all. You have to kick out loads of it, like the database piece, clip art, templates. The list goes on and on. Canonical actually funded the package kit integration, so you can stumble across a bit that doesn't work, and it says, why don't you just install it? Which is kind of cool. But of course, there's lots of distro-specific work there around naming needed. So the last bit of my talk, I guess, is just a rant about the problems of generic Linux. If you build a package that runs on any Linux, you really have some interesting problems. This is the ISV problem for Linux, and it's basically intractable. We have real trouble doing it, and we create Linux distributions. We're really relatively skilled and have a reasonable amount of time. So if you compile on a new Linux system, which is where you'd like to compile, of course, glibc has all these symbol versions that immediately bound into your library, so it just won't run on anything older. So it's necessary to build on the oldest possible platform that you can get your hands on. That used to be RHEL 4. Of course, installing the very oldest platform you can possibly get your hands on the very fastest hardware you can possibly get to try and build, not good. RHEL 4s probably have a whole load of service packs, but just discovering, the latest kind of hard disk, for example, is quite a challenge there. And also, it's not just the oldest platform you want. You need to then install all this new stuff on it, like a KDE 4 or glib with GIO. And that's really impossible too, because all of these things drag in a huge slew of dependencies, none of which are in the base system or have a different version there. So you're basically completely stuffed. It's really not good. So our generic Linux builds, unfortunately, still have no KDE 4 support, even though the code is all written and shipping in distros. So when you get a distro, that's fine. You control the whole world, right? You just recompile for every version of your distro. But if you want to run on any distro, then that's reasonably hard. And so one of the major wins here we've done is pulling up to RHEL 5 as a baseline. But even so, that's not new enough for a whole load of things that people want to do. Which is lame. Now, actually, it should be really easy to build and compile on a system just by putting shim libraries in. So I had a really vile Perl script and some stuff that would essentially take a shared library and pull all the symbols out and create another shared library, well, actually generates assembler, that just generates those symbols. So you can link against that shared library, all looks good. There are actually no dependencies on that library either, so it doesn't drag a whole load of random stuff from the system in. And that would be cool, wouldn't it? And then just drop the headers on the system, link to this library that really has nothing in it, but at least convinces you're not using symbols that aren't there. And that should be really good. Didn't work for me. I think one of the problems is that C++ likes to have objects which are copied between these things, certainly into binaries. They would be copied. So it would be good to have some help. If someone wants to come along and it's a tool chain interested person wants to do some hacking there, I think we can solve this problem generally so that you can just dump a bundle of headers on your system and get a development environment that you can build for a certain strata of Linux and install libraries into that without any dependencies that would allow you to build against them. But hey, no one really cares about the ISV ecosystem, it seems. What else do we have? Because you don't know what system you're on and what's going to be there, it's pretty difficult. So you DL open everything, So why link when you can DL open and hook symbols out by their name? I hate to pick on the evolution guys, but in terms of the APIs we used, nothing changed in the ABI there at all. So the exact same code can be run against all of these. As long as you're hooking the right symbols out, but of course they bumped the ABI, the shared library version regularly, which is pretty lame. The same story for the KDE address book. If you're using Java, it's a nightmare across platforms. Selecting which Java you want, linking it, running the magic shim before your process starts that gets LD library path correct so that you can actually link the things and it actually works. We're saying the ODBC libraries. We used to DL open cups and font config too. Do you remember names when font config didn't exist on Linuxes or was misconfigured? We coped with that. But we've pulled up our baseline now. So those are the things that we DL open from nothing. Other things we link to at compile time, and then we DL open the bit that links to it. And so that's what we do for our X, GTK 2 or 3, KD 3 or 4 backends. And we support Trinity too, which is another random variant of KD 3, I think. So yeah, that's quite exciting for an ISV. And that's all because people want good integration with their desktop of choice, with their scanner, with their fasts and so on. So there you are. Here's the conclusions. Well, it's fun to package LibreOffice, you know? If you want something, if you want an easy life, you know, pick something easy. But we have some real challenges. And there's, you know, a lot of fertile work, low-hanging fruit. You know, that package config stuff, for example, is a matter of adding a few lines to various places in the thing. And, you know, suddenly the user experience is just much better. Well, yeah, I mean, there's lots of ways to get involved in LibreOffice. I have a talk about it, I believe, tomorrow. It's much more general about LibreOffice 4. And yeah, thank you for your support. I mean, you know, LibreOffice would be nothing if it were not for lots of people, you know, caring about it and helping evangelize it. And we have a huge cliff face of brand, you know, awareness to climb. And so we really appreciate your help with all of that. So yeah, thank you so much for coming. Does anyone have any questions, as they say in the movies? What is your name? I must remember it. You are an ace asker of questions, and you know that's much appreciated.
So actually uses the generic Linux builds. I mean,
that's a really good question.
Get their stuff from distros?
Yeah. Why would you not get it from your distro? Does anyone download them? So that's a question. That's a good question. We do have stats. There are two stats that you can use. One is the download rate, which I think the download rate is about 3% of downloads. Like the vast majority of Windows and then Mac. I think in terms of unique IPs that we see coming to our update service. So Linux distro vendors don't tend to point to our update service. They just patch that out, turn it off at configure time. But all the generic builds we ship will phone home to say, is there a new version? And so that gives us the distro, It gives us the platform, for sure. And so there it's 2% Linux, 10% Mac, and the rest Windows. So yeah, not many people use it. But it's possible that they are a self-selecting cross-section of the awful people with the RHEL 4s, you know, Fedora 2s, or whatever it is, right? You know, OpenSUSE 1, you know, and that they really want that build, but it works for them. It may be. I don't know. Let's hope not, because they're about to get quite a surprise with LibreOffice 4. But you know, I don't know. If you read Gartner reports and you believe them, then there's something like a 2-yearly cycle of rollover of Linux desktops. So the hope is that as long as we're, you know, kind of inside that or outside that, most people will be happy. Does that help?
Well, I guess I was wondering, like, are you able to
Yeah. So the interesting thing is that if you look at our download numbers, and maybe I'll look at these, I think they're in my talk tomorrow, then yes, there's large numbers of people downloading, but then there are, you know, large numbers of people getting Linux as well. Our download rate is in excess of OpenSUSE plus Fedora, so that's good and growing strongly, but we don't have any statistics for Ubuntu. They're simply not public, which is sad. And the, you know, I guess we could install some phone home, you know, thing there and kind of pwn them or something. But we haven't done that. So yeah, it comes down to using a good. I mean, what proportion do you think Ubuntu is of the Linux desktop market? So you can look at Wikipedia, I suppose, and who connects to it and so on. But I don't know. It's all peeing in the dark. But at least Google Trends suggests it's quite a lot. So I think a large proportion of our end users are probably Linux users, but the vast majority of our downloads are Windows users. Does that help? Cool. Good question. Ah, look at it. Oh, one at the back. Sorry, with the microphone. Yes.
Two questions. Stats. Do you get anything in Debian? It's called popularity contest. I'm not sure what the other distros do.
So well, we're so popular, you know, we just maxed it out. You know, it kind of blew up. I don't know, actually. That's okay. A good question.
And second question, is there any hope for reducing the number of dependencies?
Yeah, I mean, it's easy to reduce the dependencies. You just, you know, say don't do any scanning or don't do any printing or don't do any. You know, I mean, you know, at some stage you need to do that. So, yeah, I mean, if you want a dependency-free build, you can install the generic builds that we produce, which have all that stuff mucked into them somehow. And then, yeah, you have a lower dependency footprint. Of course, if you do a good job of packaging, hopefully you don't have, you know, like GTK2, GTK3, KDE3, and KDE4 installed concurrently because, hey, they picked which desktop you're using and you get a sensible backend. So, yeah, those are really just packaging problems rather than end-user bloat problems. But yeah, for sure, we're always looking out to reducing bloat, and you know, one of the things we've done is reducing unused code, so you know, code that's never called, never used, and we can prove that. We've been ripping out at top speed. So yeah, you know, at the end of the day, so there was a guy in my company, and I was arguing with him about the merits of rewriting the whole world in JavaScript. And sadly, he was a very influential person, so it was quite a long argument. And during the argument, he said, lines of code is no measurement of functionality. And I think at the extremes, probably he's right. But you know, at some stage, if you want functionality, you have to write some code to do it. I think that, you know. But apparently, if you have a startup mentality, you don't need to. So that's great. Maybe we just need a startup mentality. So does that help? Cool. Good question. Thank you. Oh, I've forgotten the question. Even better. Even better. Anyone else that's looking shy? You know, how long have we got? Ages. Is it ages? 7 minutes.
7 minutes.
Oh, that's. I'll go for the question on the first talk. If you can continue remembering, is that possible? I'll repeat it, so we don't need the mic. Just I'm going to repeat the question.
Repeat so, the first talk.
I'll repeat the first talk. Yeah. Go for it, sir.
So you talked about the three different types of relationships.
Yeah, yeah.
And so for an example would be an open cause model, which has both a mutual relationship and a authoritarian type relationship.
Uh-huh.
Is there some sort of... The point of that is it's you're supposed to use one type of model, or is it fine to have hybrids?
So I think the one destroys the other, pretty much. I think you're in a dominance relationship in that case. The open core model I don't believe in. I think it's dangerous for free software. And so, yeah, I think ultimately you can try and pretend to other people back a lesser set of rights than you have. You can pretend that. But profoundly, the reason isn't actually any mutualism there, is there? You're giving the rights to someone else, and he chooses what rights he gives back to you. So yeah, I think that just recasts the relationship in a way that is fundamentally not a communality relationship, it's a dominance relationship. And that can be fine. You know, you can have a boss that's really good, let's face it. Your boss can be the best boss in the world, he can let you do what you want, he can, you know, and at the extreme, that's fine, you know, but at the end of the day, he is your boss, and someday, the day will come when he says, I think you need to consider whether this is for the good of the company or for what, you know, do you see what I'm saying? And so that relationship is clearly not, yeah, and I think when you're relating to a large body of contributors, it's important to get the very basics of that relationship right. Does that help?
Yeah.
I mean, it's my view. It may be completely wrong, as you know, but yeah.
And perhaps it's a bit more complex because I have dominant relationships with our contractors who have to give me every possible copyright, right, trademark, and so on they produce.
For sure.
So I can GPL it.
Yeah, and that's great. You know, so I'm not arguing you should never have a dominance relationship. I think you know that I'm quite pleased to be employed. You know, so you know that's not my argument. My argument then is what are the rights you're giving to other people? And you know it's to some degree it's okay to be upfront about the fact this is a dominance relationship. You will do what you're told. We will accept only what you want. And you know if you look at Google for example, they're quite upfront about the fact that Android is a you know, they're doing it themselves. The fact that they throw it over the wall and give it to other people is good. And I wouldn't want to criticize that. But I think there is a richer way of interacting. It's just more scalable and more fair and more... Do you see what I'm saying? Yeah? Cool.
So you were talking about the number of Windows users who've picked up LibreOffice.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
How did they ever find it?
How did they ever find it? There's this great thing called Google, you know, and you type free, you know. Yes, so I think we have, as I might have mentioned, we have a branding cliff face to climb. You know, for many years we spent a lot of time telling people openoffice.org. And that's a shame, since actually we didn't own that brand. It was owned by a corporation, and it's kind of hard to fix that later. So how do we tell those people? Well, I think it's reasonable to say that, you know, LibreOffice is in large part a successor of the OpenOffice community. Mm. I think that's something I'd happily say to people. You know, the vast majority of people that I work with, I've worked with for years and have been there. You know, in terms of the number of Sun employees that are on the project, we have more in LibreOffice than anything else. You know, we've retained a lot of the skills. We just don't happen to have, you know, some of the other pieces. So yeah, I think the name is kind of unfortunate from an adoption perspective. On the other hand, I love the concept of freedom that Libra gives you, even if it's hard to pronounce, you know, liberty. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Does that help?
Yeah, a bit.
Yeah, how did they find it?
One that it just seems a very attractive.
Okay, so a second answer would then be media. You know, that if you look at where you get hits from, clearly having articles in the press saying LibreOffice is cool, you know, does these dozen things, you know, really well, helps.
And what's the long-term relations between your code base and things like NeoOffice and other things?
Gosh, NeoOffice, as I understand it, is kind of dying a death, unfortunately, and I like the guys that do it. You know, there are some really good guys, Patrick and Ed. I think they're struggling to have a business model that pays them to do what they do. Yeah. The other thing is that the primary difference between NeoOffice and us, although they're based on the precursor to LibreOffice, is that they use Java for doing all of their text rendering and stuff at the bottom. And so, you know, they get some of the benefits of using Cortex and nice text layout, but, you know, we'd rather use Cortex directly and not bootstrap a JVM every time you start just to render text and do your graphics. Okay. So, does that help?
And I mean, I haven't run a Mac in a while. Is LibreOffice now a decent Mac app in terms of how it behaves like it, or does it look like a Windows app on a Mac?
So we're doing a whole load of stuff to improve the look of LibreOffice. And again, I recommend my talk tomorrow to you, assuming it's not up against the other, you know, five best talks in the conference. But we're doing some work there to improve the look. How it looks on Mac, I don't know. I'm not a Mac user.
Well, neither am I.
I'd encourage you to use less.
That one seemed to properly use the bar, the title bar.
Right.
The menu bars and other things.
Right.
For a naive user, that seemed to be the difference.
Mm-hmm.
It's a long time since I even looked at it.
So we use the Unity menu now on Linux, but you know, I forget if we're turning that on for Mac. So is that
one on there?
One.
It looks like a Mac.
Excellent.
You could easily recommend it to someone who doesn't want to spend money on word processors or on something to get the job done.
Awesome. Thank you for your endorsement. Yeah, so that's encouraging to me, anyway. The other thing is that we fixed a number of accessibility bugs recently. So Mac uses accessibility increasingly for all sorts of funky features, and that was just, you know, killing the suite, really. But we fixed a number of those such that it's a lot more robust on Mac now. So, yeah. Last question, I'm afraid.
With such a complex build, how do you go about the practical problem of getting personnel to sort of to work on Windows, for example, which is such an important platform for delivering people free software.
For sure.
But how do you motivate developers to help you with such a large packaging problem on Windows?
So on Windows, we have Tinderboxes, and there's a company called Bytemark, a hosting provider in the UK, that very generously gave us a very big beast of a machine with umpteen SSDs and so on and so on, that actually compiles LibreOffice and Windows in a matter of a couple of hours, or is it 3 or 4 hours, something like that. Which is pretty good going. I mean, Linux, of course, you can get it in about 15 minutes if you have the 1,000 CPU, 64 CPU beast. So the Tinderbox then at least gives you a reasonable buildability thing. Of course, the unit tests that run during that also tell you that it's going to start run, the basic functionality works. But it's always a challenge getting anyone to care about Windows in the free software world. And we do reasonably well. I mean, we employ someone full-time. A lot of SUSE's customers are actually on Windows. So one of the little-known features is that, you know, we support and ship this thing as MSI files and MSI patch files, and we do level 3 support for that on Windows for paying customers. And so, you know, if you happen to have a 10,000-seat deployment you want to talk to me about, you know, there you go. Of course, we have an interest then in keeping it working really well on Windows and fixing that. So, great questions. Thank you so much for your time.